Hey, everyone, and welcome to Make Business Better. I'm Zach Seward, the CEO and co-founder of Quartz. Every Tuesday at 11 a.m. Eastern Time on LinkedIn, Facebook, YouTube, I've been talking with executives who are trying to make their slice of the business world a little better in some shape or form, and more importantly, are willing to come on the show and share some tips and tricks that we can all apply in our own work and lives. For today's episode, we're going to be talking about making environmental sustainability a part of your business model directly. You know, we talk about companies where maybe that's not, they're trying to mitigate the impact they have on the environment, or take environmental considerations into consideration, but it is not the core of what they do. In this case, I want to talk about where opportunities where the core business operation includes increasing environmental sustainability. And our guest to talk about that is John Lagerling, who's the CEO of Mercari, a marketplace for the resale of consumer goods, or sometimes known as thrifting, whatever you want to call it. It had a huge year in 2020 due to changing habits caused by the pandemic. And resale has just been on the rise for the last decade or so in really interesting ways. And so let's start, as always, with the Quartz Essentials on this topic. I just wanted to share a smattering of statistics, and I should note most of these stats that we'll share are coming from companies that are in the resale industry, and so obviously have a stake in showing this, but I think make a pretty strong argument nonetheless. One important thing to note is that the fashion industry has a huge environmental footprint. One quite alarming stat, 5 billion pounds of return goods end up in U.S. landfills each year. So just the U.S., just talking about goods that were returned, 5 billion pounds every single year. And the rise of fast fashion, as Quartz, as Mark Bain has written about excellently over the last several years, has only exacerbated the impact that the fashion industry is having on the environment. But there are some new trends that are also worth staying attuned to, and that is people saying they have too much stuff. When surveyed, Americans in this particular survey are talking about sort of decluttering their lives. You know, does this pen spark joy? No, I'll throw it out. That kind of thing. And that may be a big reason we're seeing such a rise in the resale market. So in our last slide, we're looking at real data for 2009 and 2019, and then a projection for 2029. Fast fashion has been the real growth story in the fashion industry to date, but the projection here is that traditional thrift and resale of fashion goods is going to overtake fast fashion by 2029. That's an aggressive prediction by the very industry that has a stake in it, but I do think for sure we'll see significant growth in the resale market over the next decade. And enough about all that from me, the non-expert. Let's bring in the expert on this topic, John Lagerling, who is the US CEO of Mercari. Mercari is a Japanese e-commerce marketplace founded back in 2013, and now operates in both Japan and the US. John joined in 2017 to lead the US team. Welcome, John.
Thank you so much for having me.
Appreciate it. Appreciate your being willing to come on. So before we jump into the topic we've been doing during the pandemic, with so many of us working from home, is using the opportunity to get to know each other a little bit in our home offices, share something in your surroundings. I understand you're in a home office, although you could convince me otherwise based on your background. What do you have to share with us?
Well, that's the trick, right? So I have this green screen that I got off, I think, some gaming streaming goods site that I bought early in the pandemic, because I've been moving rooms. I have a little toddler at home, and I shouldn't blame him, but he likes having fun and yelling and making noises. I've been moving between rooms, but no one would know because I always pulled up this green screen wherever I can go, and it's been working out pretty well. So I guess I could go on a vacation somewhere in Hawaii, and I would still look the same light, same green screen. So that's my little virtual studio here.
Excellent. Well, I like the idea of using a green screen just for the green. It's a very lovely shade.
You've picked
a
little green on it.
Yeah, a little muter than a shade of green than you typically see with those green screens. Well, I like that tip. my staff and the viewers of this show have seen a very constant background as well, but it is an actual room, empty room behind me, not a green screen. So John, I started with all of those stats just to establish both the growth of the industry you're in and also start to tease out what might be driving some of this growth. When I was preparing for the interview, I was delighted to see that Quartz wrote a story about Mercari way back in 2014, very soon after it launched.
Very early.
This is why everyone should read Quartz to stay on the top of trends, because 7 years later, you aired your first Super Bowl commercial this year. I want to hear the short version, I suppose, of the story of how Mercari went from, that one press hit in Quartz that made the difference, I'm sure, to the sort of explosive growth you've seen over, and especially in the last year.
Well, as any good entrepreneur, and you're one yourself, any early PR is obviously very appreciated. And, you know, you don't forget who rooted for you early on. You also don't forget who didn't believe in you early on. And it's been kind of fun to prove some of our supporters right and some of our detractors wrong.
Well, let me step in.
Make it in the US. And I guess
I was going to step in and say, like, what were the detractors saying? Was that the main narrative? Like, it's hard for a Japanese company to break into the US market?
I think so. Any foreign company coming to the US market is seen with some level of skepsis for some reason. And as you hear, I have an accent. I'm from Europe. I lived in Asia for many years. I saw a lot of American companies fail in Asia. So it's hard to go to a different continent, you know, but I do think, luckily, the concept that we had, and, you know, as you mentioned, I've been with the company since 2017, but even prior to that, the founder, Yamada Shin, who's the person I now report to and who's been someone I've known for over a decade, even prior. He founded a company in Japan together with a couple of acquaintances based on that the big web-based selling sites don't really work for normal busy people, that they're really directed to small and medium businesses almost. You know, many of these auction sites or secondhand sites are dominated by merchants, and they saw an opening to do something that was mobile first. And really for regular folks that just want to have an item that they want to sell and get rid of, just like regular people buy from e-commerce, it makes sense to have that other side of the other direction of the equation work. And that really took off in Japan. And pretty soon thereafter, they decided to launch in the US. And they did that by simply translating the application into English and launching very early in the US, which I found very impressive. To just, you know, they just went for it, and they did well for a couple of years in having early adopters and, you know, press like Quartz kindly covered. But, you know, it was still a little under the radar, and it's now in the last 4 years, I'd say that it's really, really taken off, and especially in the last year, it's been basically a rocket ship.
Well, so I get the skepticism of, the difficulties of Japanese companies breaking into the US market. I imagine, and you alluded to, the other major skepticism must have been, well, haven't you heard of this giant called eBay, you know, or Craigslist? Like, isn't the second-hand marketplace solved on the internet? Obviously, it wasn't, because it's not just Mercari that's been able to show, like, there's a lot of room for growth here. And I heard you say, you know, so mobile first and focus on the individual. Those are really the two big differentiators from the giants of secondhand goods.
I think the other absolutely key one is simplicity. We don't want to dominate. You know, a lot of mobile apps aim to try to maximize the time spent for the user, and we're really not about that. And we're really about making sure that you can list your item. We're a camera first application. You take a picture of the thing you want to sell, you put in a little description, set a price, and boom, your listing is live, and you can go on with your life and wait for someone to discover the item and hopefully buy it. And once it's sold, we provide a shipping label. You don't have to even think about that. And we try to keep it extremely simple. That simplicity, I think, is a key focus for us that's helped a lot as well.
To avoid having to feel like you're becoming a part-time professional reseller.
And all good for people who want to do that. But there are other platforms for that. And we want to make sure that even if you show up and you don't have a history of thousands of positive reviews as a buyer or seller, you can still come in and sell on Mercari and be successful, because all the other sellers are pretty much like you as well.
Yeah. So there's really been these two generations of online resale. Mm-hmm. You had the debut of the now giants of eBay and Craigslist, mm-hmm. which both mm-hmm. happened to be created in 1995. And now I don't know what if you use the term in your industry, it feels like a second wave of resellers such as yourselves and plenty of others. And you've mentioned sort of tactically how you're able to, you know, wedge into the market with, you know, just more consumer friendly features. But it seems like there's also been a shift in perception of secondhand goods in between those two phases of online resale, and a lot of that driven by concern about the impact that people are having on the environment through, you know, churning through lots of clothes and other goods. Is that a fair read as another significant difference between the two generations?
Absolutely. I think the attitude to something that has been pre-owned has changed a lot. I think a lot of people have realized too that a lot of things are bought and never used. And, you know, you might think, well, the US has a very liberal return policy often. But even if you bought something, you don't want to return it the next day. You put it on a shelf or you put it in your wardrobe and you think you're going to use that item. And then you kind of get out of that window of reasonably returning something. So one third of items sold on Mercari actually are, yes, pre-owned, but unused and new in a sense, or like new. I think that alone has made a difference for people. And I do think the circular economy and the value thereof, even though we don't lead with that, because I want to make sure that we build Mercari in a way that people just want to use us because of the immediate benefits. Because I think the environmental benefits, it's a longer span issue. In a sense, we want to almost hack the system so that buying and selling online is so easy and so, as a matter of fact, value for you in daily life, that the environmental aspect of it, the value comes secondarily, but it happens. Mm-hmm. And I think so. We don't lead with environmental message, but it's absolutely there as an additional benefit.
Well, let's dig into that, because I get what you're saying there. Like, and a lot of different brands with environmental messages have taken various different tacks on this. What is the debate like internally? I have to imagine if discussed, though, we should be, we should lead or make bigger part of our branding, that, you know, the impact you can have on the environment by buying secondhand. So what's the argument on the other side, and why do you end up falling on not doing that?
Well, I think people get it already. We don't have to rub it in a sense. I think people are increasingly environmentally conscious and responsible. And by providing a place for unused items to then be used again, there's value on both sides of the equation. If you go and buy something from e-commerce, you're buying from a big corporation, but here you're actually buying from other families or other individuals in America. And that kind of buying and selling between people in itself on an emotional level, I think, feels really relevant. There's so many layers to this that are positive that we felt that we don't want to have just that kind of one environmental message as the beacon, but we would like to have the whole experience, I think, make sense. And that differentiation is quite big. I think for people who actually experience Mercari and they feel it once they've done it. And I have a personal story. I sold a child car seat down to someone in SoCal, and this is not a person that I'm ever going to meet. We don't do meetups. Everything that sells on Mercari ships. But it felt really good to ship that seat off to, you know, a mother down in SoCal that is now going to have her little kid in it, you know, and my kid has been in that one, and it's not going on the pile of you know, garbage, but it's actually being used, and it was in very good condition, and that felt special. And I think that emotion is something that our users feel a lot. That's, you know, in addition to all of the other benefits on environment and you managing your finances better because you can actually get money out of things that you've used for a while.
Got it. Yeah, I see that, and you know, arguably, it's a good sign for folks pushing for more environmentally conscious forms of business that you can sort of choose not to lead with that as their selling point and more, you know, embed it into it's part of the value proposition and obviously part of the what the company is accomplishing, but not the only thing. Well, I know that you're coming off of a pretty crazy year, 2020. Mm-hmm. I mean, we all are. But I'm guessing yours was a little busier than average because there was just an explosion in interest in secondhand marketplaces as the first wave of the pandemic hit, well, at least in Europe and the US. So tell us a little bit about that story. What was the inflection point, and how did things go from there?
Well, I think a lot of businesses saw an acceleration of a trend that was already happening, and I think that that was really the case for us too. That we were at a very good growth trajectory, where more and more people were discovering Mercari per se, but also our existing users' activity was going up. And I think around this time of last year, we did see an inflow of a lot of new users, but more than anything, our existing users just started expanding their activity into more categories. People who had been buying and selling clothes mainly, and you know, we're all over the place in terms of categories. You can buy and sell almost anything on Mercari. We saw people all of a sudden being in need of an iPad, or you know, being in need of getting rid of something and making that into cash, because everything just changed overnight in terms of people's lives. And obviously, you know, early on, a lot of people, there were some PPE, you know, some of the, you know, masks and things that we wanted to make sure that we go to healthcare. So we had our machine learning team go in and make sure that, you know, things weren't, you know, resold.
Oh, try to identify masks getting posted.
Exactly, exactly. To make sure that you know, we're recovering the categories that we should, and not the ones that should go to healthcare. So technology, I think, really played a big part in making sure that this wave of usage still, you know, worked well for our system. And we had a couple of weeks there where we had a lot of hands on deck to make sure that, you know, that overnight basically doubling of activity was well serviced. Honestly, that trend has continued. It's still at an extremely high level of growth. And I think a lot of people have discovered the benefits even now when the pandemic is kind of slightly, hopefully, you know, ebbing out.
Yeah, and I want to hear more about that growth and where you think things go from here. But there's just one quick detail about those early days. Is this like a machine learning algorithm you've applied to try to screen out other goods that are not allowed to be sold on the platform, and then now suddenly needed to be applied to identify masks and other PPE?
That's right, Zach. I think we've always employed technology in a way that we don't want it to be in your face for our customers, but we do price recommendations. We do weight as in shipping label estimations and recommendations for our sellers. And also we do moderation. So we have machine learning in place to make sure that we have a safe marketplace with items that are acceptable within our terms of use. And all of that has always been working in the background, but then overnight, yes, we had this additional category of items that we did not want on our sites. And, you know, we felt that we're glad that we had all that infrastructure so we could respond to something that just came very sudden. So we do want to make sure that selling and buying on Mercari is extremely easy, but in the background, there's a lot of kind of sweating and tears, making sure that we want to make it look easy. But it is not necessarily always with the necessity of the technology really making that happen.
It's always harder to keep things simple.
It's our job to make it look easy, right? And then it's for us. It's like in music, you can hear an amazing song, and you should really know that they've been working on that for like weeks and weeks and weeks and so many takes, and then it comes together and sounds like it's just beautiful and natural. I have a lot of respect for all crafts and how much work that goes in. And I have special thanks to our engineering and product teams and moderation teams that worked so hard over the last 12 months, if I can say that.
The equivalent in digital media, I like to think, is the nightmare of menus upon menus that every newspaper website laid out like a newspaper.
And then all the ads too, right? Because you also have to monetize, and how do you make all of that balance? Yeah.
And I always like to say that the difference between a well-designed and poorly designed news site is the poorly designed ones, you can see the org chart on the site itself. So, yeah. You know, like circulation said, slap this thing here, and the ad department said, slap this thing here, never the twain shall meet. But keeping it simple and while satisfying all your business needs is quite difficult,
but of course,
part of the idea and the value we provide for.
I think the interesting thing for us, or for me, you know, as I joined the company many years ago, is that I've always been a business facing consumers for things that I've done in my career. But here we have consumers and consumers, and they're really interacting with each other. And we are trying to do whatever we can with technology to make that an enjoyable experience. And that challenge is very interesting in how do we motivate everyone to work together in a way that really becomes enjoyable and beneficial, you know, both economically and, you know, make it worth their time to sell and send that item and make it worth your time to actually go and find that item. And it's changed people's consumption behavior too, because when you buy an item now, you do so with a view of knowing that you might be able to actually sell this item. So if there's a good, better, best digital camera, for example, from some company, let's say Panasonic or Sony or something like that, you can actually buy the better or the best one and enjoy that higher tier of good, because you know you'll be able to sell it and get some of that money back. And we saw that in Japan, and we're also seeing that behavior here in the US, which is so interesting that it's a universal kind of thing that's happening thanks to secondary markets.
Oh, sure. If you can, as long as there's enough liquidity, so to speak, in the,
yes,
in the secondary
markets. For most categories, whether it's sports cards or squishmallows or let's see, what's a hot category lately? Even puzzles during the pandemic. Some of these categories have been just extremely liquid, which has been very interesting to see how that just goes up.
So you had this, you know, singular moment in time of a pandemic that really, you know, caused a dramatic rupture in consumer habits in all sorts of ways, some of which are, you know, going to go snap back to normal, others will continue, and we don't have to try to be futurist of it and predict all of those trends. But what do you expect to remain permanent post-pandemic, let's hope, about the secondhand marketplace and Mercari in particular? What are the new things you've seen in the last year that you're counting on continuing into 2022 and beyond?
We've seen an inflow of people coming online to sell things that have never sold online before. And that is here to stay. Many of them, I think, are surprised that their item can actually sell, because if you don't have experience with selling, you might think that you need a perfect description, a perfect image of your item with the best lighting possible and hundreds of positive reviews as a seller for your profile. And that is not really necessary. We abstract away some of those complexities of the logistics, of the trust, because we hold the funds from buyers until an item arrives, so we know that we can release the funds once it's safely arrived and it is as described. So all of those things have made it possible for, I think, complete noobs to sell online and do so very successfully. And I don't think that sometimes you need a little extra motivation to try that new thing and get out of your comfort zone, but I think once you've experienced it, and obviously we're looking at the data, people continue. And I don't think that the 2021, whatever that's going to be, you know, we're only in May now, that those changes are going to dial back that trend. Genie is kind of out of the bottle on selling online for regular, consumers, and that's here to stay.
Does the data show what those noobs, as you said, were doing with their stuff previously? Obviously, having too much shit is not a new trend. So, are they hoarders? Is it going to get Goodwill? What was their what part of the market do you feel like you've now captured?
There are more self storage outlets in America than there are Starbucks retail locations. I think there are billions spent in paying companies to store stuff that's unused, and I think that is something that we're starting to chip away at. Or it's a garage, or it's a drawer, or it's a kitchen drawer, or it's your cupboard. It's people have been storing a lot of things. Some people have just blatantly been throwing things away. I think for things like electronics, a lot of it might get handed to, your cousin or your the next generation. Last year's iPhone might go to someone you know.
I have a drawer in at home that is dedicated to everyone. Has that drawer? Yes.
Yes, and the thing is, there are people who really want to buy that item, and just wipe the memory, of your electronic item and list it, and it actually these things sell, and they have an expected price range, and we even guide you on that, and that value is there.
Is there is there demand for micro USB cables on Mercari? Because I got a handful of those.
we all have these massive snake pits of cables, I know. But that might not be
the place to start.
Surprisingly, there are still electronics, you know, these little USB fans, if it's hot, you know, or whatever. Older micro USB are still alive and kicking. So you might have a try if you bundle it well. And if you take a nice image of it, I think it might work. And just keep your expectations on what you should sell it for, you know, reasonably moderate, and it should work out.
Your answer was doubly relevant, because not only do I have this drawer full of electronics that I never use, but I also have a Manhattan mini storage unit that you could probably do without. That
Paying that monthly invoice and treat yourself to something that you actually want. That would be my advice from Mercari to you.
One of many post-pandemic spring cleanup tasks, I think. Well, John, this is really helpful. I appreciate your time and all the answers, and good luck managing all that growth. Obviously, a good problem to have, but a problem nonetheless. I'm sure. Hope we can have you back on in 7 years' time after and talk about how the impact of this video interview, you know, what that impact was on the company's trajectory over the next decade.
Well, thank you, Zach. I hope it doesn't take 7 years, but thanks for covering us back then. That really meant a lot to us, and it still means a lot. So anytime. Thank you.
Of course. Yeah, no, our pleasure. Have a great day.
You too. Take care.
That's it for today's episode of Make Business Better, but we'll be back here next Tuesday at 11 a.m. Eastern time. As always, follow us on LinkedIn, Facebook, YouTube to get notified every time we go live. In the meantime, I hope you all have a great day. I'll see you in here next Tuesday.